everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson, back here with Tom Martell, and we've got a great top eight list for you today. I think this was, you would not shut up about this. You really wanted to do this one.
I am very behind this top eight list. It's the history of Magic, all in a little encapsulated in a nutshell.
I guess. I mean, you know something's popular when people talk about it enough to kind of give it a nickname or...
Sure. I mean, that's... You don't give nicknames to things you're not going to keep bringing up, right? Because the whole reason is... You feel familiar with this card or this concept or this person, and so you have a nickname to show that it's usually endearing or some aspect of you know nostalgia comes from these names.
We could have gone the cheap route. I mean, a lot of cards have nicknames. We're doing card nicknames, by the way.
If we've kind of implied.
But we usually would say, you know, things are shortened and those are their nicknames. Mm-hmm. Birds of Paradise.
Bop.
Swords of Plowshares.
Plow. This is, yeah, these are not very clever.
No, they're not exciting.
Fuff, you know, yeah. Like, I mean, you can kind of figure it out.
Right. So we had to go a step deeper, and it made things a little bit different. We could have just done, you know, 12 invitational cards or whatever. And
sure. But we did a couple, but still, yeah.
Like, some of them are really, I mean, they're iconic. What, how are you not going to do them? Yeah. We'll start with the honorable mention. Some would call him Jens. Most would call him the sad robot. We're talking about Solemn Simulacrum.
Yeah, and if you've ever seen the picture of Solemn Simulacrum, he looks quite sad to be there on this Magic card, which to me seems like a cool thing to be on. I'd be pretty happy, but...
I don't, you know, I'd really like to hear the backstory about how this artwork came about, because they're making him a robot, but he's wearing glasses.
I mean...
A little rare for a robot.
How do you know? How many robots do you know?
I don't
maybe
know.
Maybe some of them have
maybe
bad
I know
eyesight.
More than I think. I don't
possible.
Know.
Yeah, I mean, the name kind of makes sense. He's a robot, and he looks sad. there's not a lot of depth to this one. It's kind of just what you see is what you get.
This isn't the most honorable of mentions we've ever given, but it's there. It's a popular name.
It is certainly, I mean, people will either know it or be able to figure it out when you say the name to them. And I think, you know, that's kind of what you'd expect out of a nickname. Although some of the cool nicknames Joshi can't figure out because they're so, like, ingrained to a story. But that doesn't tend to happen in Magic cards, though.
No.
These are much more tied to, like, the art and the flavor of the card. So he is a sad robot.
I think art goes a long way on most of these.
That's what I was thinking. Although one of them, which we'll get to eventually, does not tie to the art, and that I think is actually very cool.
Might be two of them, actually. But regardless, let's move to number eight, which is very very much has to do with artwork, but very much also has to do with the fact this card saw so much play. We're talking about good old Dr. Teeth.
Sagatog. Yeah, with his very sharp smile.
Why he's a doctor, I don't understand.
Yeah, I mean, many things in Magic are doctors without really understanding why. So... That just the kind of nickname that evolved, and you know, people started calling him that in tournament play. And he did see a ton of play. You know, he dominated formats. You know, before there were fairies, there were Sagatog decks, and he was there smiling at you as he, you know, 20G repeatedly. So,
what's more or less fun to play against of those options? Would you rather play against a fairies deck or a Sagatog?
Much rather play against Sagatog. Fairies is so bitter blossom. Oh, not fun to play against.
All right. It's not like Sagatog where it's like, because at Sagatog they don't have to show it to you. Like with fairies, like they kind of have to like have the cards for it to work. With Tog, they can just literally do nothing.
Yeah, until they get to nine and then they just upheaval and get you. Yeah, it's true. That is true.
Either way. Number seven here, again, iconic artwork of Magic. We're talking about the Sex Monkeys.
So this is old school for those of you who you know didn't go that far back. But yeah, Sex Monkeys, I mean, I remember I was like a kid. This was like 2000 era. They came out like 98.
But yeah, no, even by, we're talking Visions here.
I started playing with them in 2000, so that's for me is tied to that era.
So when you found this little like pubescent joke,
yes,
it was all the way in the year 2000.
And I was happy, but if you ever seen the art, obviously for Uktabi Orangutan, which is the card we're talking about, they are in a somewhat compromising pose, and
it's important to know there are three monkeys in the picture. I think that's at first glance. I remember being a kid and like it's not that you don't get it. It's more that you're just kind of like, he's like grabbing this branch and grabbing the other branch. I don't get it.
Yeah.
And you're like, well, no, look again. Yeah. You're like, oh, there's other things going on in that picture.
There's some stuff happening in that background.
And as high as the brow is for Magic card players and how they view things.
We are very mature people, and we don't really stoop to
this one stuck immediately.
Oh, yeah.
When was the last time you heard someone say Uktabi Orangutan?
I don't know if I ever have.
I mean, you said it a little while ago.
I mean,
you were able to pronounce it. It came out.
True.
But beyond that, have you ever been anywhere at an event? Is like, yes, and then someone Uktabi Orangutanged my Grim Monolith, and I ended up losing that game.
These days it might come out, because it's no longer in the kind of collective consciousness of Magic. It's not on the tip of your tongue. Back then, you'd always call them Sex Monkeys, and everyone talked about them. Now it's so weird to be talking about them in general. Like, why would you be talking about
Sex Monkeys?
Well,
there's also Viridian Shaman.
True, who is just
the elves are slightly more relevant.
And they're better behaved. which we see in the artifact card. So, you know, it's evolved.
I don't want to draw conclusions there, but yes, yes. that is the long history of the Utabi orangutan. Most I've said that word, that card name.
Ever?
Ever. Yeah. Easily, ever.
Yeah. It kind of rolls off the tongue, though. Utabi orangutan. No, yeah. It doesn't at all.
No.
It's a tongue twister.
Number six on our list here. Again, one of those things where it's like, have you ever actually said Shadow Mage Infiltrator?
I have. I mean, you call it a Finkel, or I guess you call them a Finkel, which is sort of strange.
There are more than one. I'm sure he has a family.
Yeah, I mean, he does. And it's odd for me, especially because I know John, and I've been out with John. I've actually pulled out a Shadow Mage Infiltrator in his presence to show to a girl he was talking to. Random asides here about Magic outside the Pro Tour life. But yeah, no, I mean, it's his card, right? It's
right, his residual, yeah. But you'd call it Shadow Mage, maybe.
Or, Johnny Magic. Like, there's a lot of things you can... It's embraced his identity, right, is in a card form. So any of his nicknames, you can apply to this card. And because he was such an iconic player for so long, there's a lot of lore there tied to him that people now have embraced and put on this card. And for a while, the card actually was good. It saw a lot of play. And I thought that, it's awesome.
For the regionals the year it was printed, I remember it being very monetarily popular.
Yeah. It was just a powerful card in that format. And... didn't Luis play it in his Fairies deck in, like, Nationals top 8 one year, if I recall correctly?
He might have had it in his sideboard I was going to say Spiral at one point, because it was in that as well. For some of those interactions.
I vaguely remember, like, him and Paul and Shion having it in one of their Fairies decks. But it came back and saw some fringe players. It saw some more fringe play.
It's still a good Magic card.
Before Finkel made a comeback. And now that we have, the card retired and the man has reemerged. So maybe that's the cyclical thing there. He stopped playing when it got good, and then when it got bad, he had to come back to get a new card.
Whoa! I'm not a spotlight in card form. I don't have Tom handing me out his party favors for some reason. We're gonna have to come back for that special. That's gonna be a good one.
Top 8 stories from the Magic Pro Tour. We need an edit
again.
Version.
More things you're committing to. I don't understand why you do these things.
That one would be fun to do. That one I'll commit to. I'll push that one.
I'll tell you what. We'll split his plane ticket. We'll bring him out here. We'll sit him down.
He's not here. It's just stories.
They're just stories. Would you prefer he wasn't?
Probably better. Yeah. They don't all have to be about him.
You have other friends?
Okay, no. Is he going to watch this and see them calling him a friend? That
would
be awkward. I would
imagine no. But I'm not going to put anything past the Magic community.
Fair point.
We reach tens of thousands of people that aren't him all the time.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
All right, next card. Moving
because
on.
It's important to make sure that they stay part of this conversation. who doesn't love... You know what? When I transitioned from things about John Finkel, I always transition to things from the... of The Rock.
So The Rock in his millions was a deck, now just called The Rock, and the name probably lost to the ages, but the original name was a deck by Sol Malka, and it was Phyrexian... Plague Lord.
Who's apparently striking a very similar Rock-esque pose.
He is.
If you were to ask somebody.
His millions, which was Deranged Hermit and Scroll Tokens.
Yeah, that is correct.
And that was kind of the core of this black-green deck, and it was, Saul played it in a bunch of, like, PDQs in that era, and it had some success. It wasn't, I don't think it was, for, like, the format-defining deck, but it had a cool name, it had a fun story behind the name, and it caught on, and yeah, for the duration in which it was played, The Rock was actually a Phyrexian Plague Lord. Which has maybe been lost. Is now you've had, like, Spiritmonger take his turn kind of being the face of The Rock, and then it's gone from there.
Definitely pulling the office when you ask, like, who is The Rock? What is The Rock? When we got semi-serious answers, you did get Spiritmonger kind of thrown in
there. Yeah, so it was the face of the deck a few years later. And people think of that card. Now people think of, like, Doran as, like, the equivalent, the modern version of, like, the flagship Rock creature. But the original, and the reason why we call the deck Rock... is not because it's black and green, but it's because it's a Phyrexian Plague Lord. And I think that's a cool little bit of magic history.
Here we are, setting the record straight. Let's talk about the Mox Monkey. We have the Sex Monkey, now we have
the Mox
Monkey.
A lot of monkeys in Magic.
They were very good, very back in the day. They do not like them.
Fair, okay. Well, maybe they're collecting them or stealing them, but they're definitely destroying them.
I don't know if it's a Planet of the Apes thing.
I don't know what's going on here, yeah. But the Mox Monkey, unlike the Sex Monkeys, liked cheap artifacts, or disliked cheap artifacts very specifically, and this is...
very aggressive tendencies towards those things.
Yeah, it's like to smash. This is Gorilla Shaman, who actually isn't even a monkey, which is probably very insulting to him. Because there's a we didn't difference come up between with this. Gorillas and monkeys. Which it just occurred to me this sitting here. But he, for one mana, blows up Moxon. Mm-hmm. And it was a staple in Vintage for a long time. Before, kind of Vintage now is more like combo-oriented and the cards are more powerful. But back then, it was very valuable to play this guy and over a couple turns, eat all your opponent's Moxes. And it saw a ton of plays in Vintage.
So much so that it came up with the nickname Muggy, we have now.
It's what it did. And it was a very single-minded kind of card.
I think of all those times you got to attack with the Mons Goblin Raiders after the dust had settled. Now here I am insulting them, calling them goblins. I feel so bad.
I mean, poor gorillas.
Now, when you think of the best, the unkillable, the most American, this is weird, you may think of Superman. And Superman, yeah. If Superman was a Magic card for a very long time, Superman would be Morphling.
I mean, under old rules, Morphling was unkillable.
Not
under
the oldest of rules.
Middle rules. Like middle rules, is that fair?
Middle rules.
Middle, yeah, whatever it is. So they're the old rules. And then we had the stack, and damage went on it. So during the damage on the stack era, really very particular what we're talking about, during that period of time, Morphling was basically unkillable. You'd attack with it. If they block, you'd pump its power up to make it lethal, put damage on the stack, and then pump its toughness up so it would survive. And it was, you give it shroud, it just could never die. And so for that reason, it was Superman. You know, it was basically, and there
he also flew from time to time.
Also jumped in the air. Yeah. He could also lift off. So for you know, years, this was like the defining card in Standard, then one of the defining cards in Extended, back when Extended was still a format.
Let's talk about the deck, for example.
I mean, Accelerated Blue is the deck I think of when I think of Morphling. But you think about the deck in Vintage, yes. I mean, it was also the finisher there. And the deck being the Brian Weissman original creation, which used Sarah Angel. Morphling is just a better version of that. And it was the finisher of choice in Vintage, which is, you know, saying a lot for
right, I think
the
history
of Magic cards.
That's the pedestal that you have to come up to. If you're going to kill somebody in the format that has all the Magic cards,
yeah.
There was a very long time where it was a 5-1 Shrouded Flyer.
The baton was handed off from Sarah in the early days to, you know, a much more powerful version, which, yeah, Morphling for a long time. And even in Vintage, I mean, Accelerated Blue as well was, you know, played in Vintage as a powerful archetype. And playing a Morphling on turn two with Blue up, you know, it was very hard to beat. And that was something you could often do there in that format. So, very, you know, it's just a card that defined, you know, Magic for a long time as being the most powerful creature.
I shed a tear now thinking that, you know, I cut it from the cube. It just sits there.
I want to play it in the cube where it is alone eroded to be able to use the stack for damage.
Wow.
I keep thinking about this because I want to bring it back because it's such a nostalgic part of Magic.
Have you thought about going the other direction where you just put R&D Secret Lair in your cube so you have to kind of assemble? And then you could have it be like you could play with whatever set of rules you wanted. I've heard people I've heard musings of like if you want to play with things that if you don't want to play you want to play exactly how they're written, you put this in your cube. Yeah. But if you also want to kind of bend things to make Morphling good, because again, it's hard to watch them go.
It makes me sad. It does.
And probably just a couple months ago, I won a match with that card right before I cut it, and I was like, really? "See, it's still good." And everyone's like, "No, it's not good anymore. It's not good." No. But I won the match. You would have won with Gray Ogre. It doesn't matter.
It no longer beats a 3/3 in combat. That's so sad. It is not the Man of Steel.
That is rough. Yeah. That is rough. On a lighter note, there's always Bob.
There is always Bob. And this is our other invitational card that's kind of on the list, named for Bob Auer. And the card obviously is Dark Confidant, which features his smiling face. Is he smiling in the picture?
He's kind of smirking, I think. Yeah, somebody's kind of smirking on that picture. I think it's him.
And, certainly the best of the invitational cards, I think, in terms of power level.
There might be a Magic TV Top 8 list for that, actually.
There is.
We rank some invitational cards.
I was alluding to it.
Okay.
I
wasn't sure.
Acting by illusion. But yeah, I mean, it's you know, format-defining card in Legacy, in Vintage. It was in Standard at the time. It was just an incredibly powerful effect. And so much of that, you know, it was just your friend Bob. You know, just hang out with Bob. Chilling,
it's interesting. It's not like it's hard to say Dark Confidant, there's no really good way to shorten it, though.
It's just like Darky. It's such a familiar
confidant now.
Such a familiar card, you know. It's just like Bob. It's like your friend. You know, just hang out with Bob. And
do your friends ever try to kill you?
Well, my friends sometimes, yes, but that might be more an issue with my friends than with friendship in general. But yeah, I mean. I don't know, it just the stories also that come out of it are really cool, and there's a lot of them. You know, like, oh, I had to survive some you know, Bob flips, And it just, I don't know, it just has become part of the kind of the experience of playing Magic.
Definitely very much so. Bob is right there. It's so much easier to just say, I need Bobs for this event, or who's got Bobs, or I, you know, did this with Bob, as opposed to be like, I'm trading for Dark Confidants right now. And
well, it'd be kind of confusing if you had like a friend named Bob, and you're like talking about like you're looking for Bob, and it's like, which, anyway, moving on.
Well,
random things I think about when these are.
It helps that the number one card on this list is Tim.
It's Tim, yeah, Bob and Tim hanging out together.
They would make an interesting duo, although if they fought against each other, Tim would definitely take Bob down. Prodigal Sorcerer, all the way back from Alpha. For those of you who aren't Monty Python fans, you won't be watching this, so I'm not talking to you anyway. Tim, the Sorcerer, Tim the Enchanter. Tim the tap to deal one to any target.
And this is the one I was thinking of when I said there'll be a card that's not the art. Although Morphling and Superman also not really art based.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, he's been called Tim since Alpha. I mean, from day one, this card was just called Tim, and then for a long time it was like different Tim effects, which was, you know, all the other pingers you would have.
We still talk about that.
Yeah. So I mean, you had always, you know, a host of them. You had the exact port when he moved into red with Prodigal Pyromancer. Right, you had various versions of Sting Barriers.
They call him Tom.
Is he called Tom?
They call Prodigal Sorcerer Tom.
Man, I'm red? Oh, that's not... Anyway, that makes me a little sad, actually.
Want to be related to Tim? You can't even take that? Here we were talking about the number one...
I don't want to be a 1-1 red creature. No. No.
When you picture yourself as a Magic card, which apparently you do, what do you picture?
I don't normally, but I don't... if I was to do so, I would not picture myself as a 1-1 red creature that costs 3 mana. And has been marginalized in all formats of Magic.
You're more like an 0-1 red creature for 5.
Yeah, probably something more like that. Yeah. Is that like is the Morph Elite from Cairo that? Is he 5 mana?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that what you actually were thinking of?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
How did I get that? We're starting to connect here.
Here I was thinking I was going to get under your radar, but that's fine. That's fine. Tim it is.
Yeah, I mean, it's cool. It's the longest lasting nickname, right? Since, I mean, this is literally from day one. I can't think of any other cards from that set that really had nicknames that have stuck.
Bubba. I mean, when I think of like Force of Nature, you never heard of Bubba? You never heard of Bubba? We used to call him Bubba.
Really?
Yeah.
No, I never did.
But it was always Tim. Tim's universal. I can't.
Everyone knows Tim.
Exactly.
Exactly. You can't talk about Prodigal. You never talked about Prodigal Sorcerer.
Right.
You know, and not even that it saw a lot of play because it never really saw that much play. But it was just such like a...
I kept trying to GM him in like opposition lists, circa 2000 or whatever.
People made attempts because it's such an iconic card, you want to play with it. Which is funny because all the other ones kind of have their names because they were played a lot.
Right.
And this one is the one that transcends that, which I think is really cool. And that's what I have to say about Tim.
It's a good list. And I mean, I just want to rattle off... I just want to just want to rattle off all these other ones that like didn't make it that we were talking about. It's like, oh, look, it's Ghost Dad and Batman.
I just thought of one, which is Miss America. Which we didn't come up with earlier.
You really like that one? Because she's red, white, and blue?
It still works. Lightning Angel certainly called Miss America, which I didn't come up with earlier. I'm just proud of myself for thinking of one.
No, you did. Congratulations.
So, yeah. you there's one more honorable mention.
But you even gave away the answer, so it's less exciting. If people have to like go look up like who's the Ghost Dad.
No one calls him the Ghost Dad. That's why I didn't make the list. It's the deck. Anyway, this could spiral out of control quickly.
We'll ask Fung. He loved that deck.
Did that deck have Talawisp in it?
I don't know. It was bad.
Yeah, it was definitely bad.
That was like a team standard. He wanted to play team standard. He convinced me to play on his team standard team. And he convinced me that deck was good. Yeah. And that he was going to play.
Everything about this is unfortunate.
Well, because that was back when you first came out. Like, you couldn't play more than 4 copies of a card.
Right.
He's like, it's okay. I'm going to play this black white thing. You can play these other cards. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry. There's just none of the good cards in the format, so we're fine. It just takes all the bad cards and builds a deck out of them. But the deck's good, I promise.
Yep.
Usually not the case. If your deck uses none of the cards anyone else wants, it's probably not actually going to end up being a good deck.
Can't you wait for Team Constructed to come back? Unified. Sorry, it has to be Unified.
Is that what they're calling it?
Unified Team. It won't be back. It won't be back.
Ever?
No. I would imagine it won't be back.
It doesn't seem that bad. They brought back Team Limited.
But that's good. Good. Sure. Team Limited, good.
Good. Yes.
Unified Team Constructed, bad.
Okay. I never actually played it. So I never did.
You're lucky.
Yeah.
I almost didn't play it, and then a certain friend of ours convinced me that it was a great idea, that I was going to love it. And I was like, I love you, and I love playing Magic. This has got to be great.
No,
what do you mean we went 2-4 or whatever? I think Sasso's team actually won that event.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, now we get the joys of fighting over Team Sealed. I want this card. No, I want this. Yeah, that's going to be delightful. I can't wait.
We've rambled on long enough. There you have it. Top 8 card nicknames from Magic with some lovely honorable mentions. Make sure to add yours in the comments because apparently...
We have been forgetting some.
Well, yeah. I mean, we forgot Miss America until 30 seconds ago. We'll go from there. Thanks for watching.